much shit for that.
They, you know, you cast genocide on one fucking race.
Well, it wasn't just one. But well, I mean, who's counting, right?
Right.
The Jews were.
One Holocaust and everybody hates you. Do we learn anything from the internet recently? I haven't really spent a whole lot of time
on
the internet.
I love that hat. It looks like you have an inside-out raven on your head.
And the scarfy bits.
Oh, match it. Oh.
Hand pockets.
Oh, Chante.
Hey, 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 you're listening to That's Life, the podcast designed with your laughter in mind. So please sit back, relax, and prepare to be entertained. That's Life.
And we're back.
Hello.
Oh, yes. Back for episode number 48. Ooh, yes. Oh, 4 and 8.
Even remembered what number we were on.
Woohoo!
Fortunately, through the magic of counting,
yay.
Here we are.
How many were? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 48. Yay!
Yes, 48.
As you can hear out there in La La Land, we've got Pater on the bike.
We are here.
We've got Pater's plus one. Say hello.
Hello.
There she
is. Lovely Cassandra.
She has she's sporting a fantastic hat.
Yes.
It's
like
fuzzy.
A spirit hood.
It is. The spirit of a raven that is cool as hell.
Yes. I hear it's
warm. I like it so much more now.
I'm smoking. And we've got a lot of fun, exciting stuff for you. This is our New Year's, continuing the holiday tradition episode. This is our New Year's episode.
Post-Christmas, pre-New Year.
We've got all kinds of exciting stuff. We have our What's New, which will include our holiday stuff, and all Pete's What's News, which are cool. I actually have What's News for once.
Oh, crap.
We have.
But we're short in internet gen, so we won't have any epic boyfriends putting their faces through glass plates.
They'll be short and sweet to the point, but they're new and they're pretty positive, most of them.
Yeah,
we have our new little segment here for the New Year's holiday. It's our failed predictions. It's a whole bunch of failed predictions about the future, about stuff that either would have already happened by now or should be happening right now,
which will be great.
A lot of them are fucked up. You're like, man, people were stupid.
I could already criticize it by saying the predictions necessarily didn't fail because they were successfully predicted. It's just that what happened
That's
in
true.
The predictions
That's true.
Didn't.
They went to predict and said prediction failure. Check your ampersands.
God
no!
damn it.
It's worse than iTunes with their RSS feed. No!
We love you, iTunes. Sponsor
yes,
us.
Yes, iTunes. We are totally... people were totally working on getting us on iTunes so that it'll spread everywhere and everyone will be as cool as you are, listeners, listening to us and giggling along.
That's right. And we can talk about iTunes comments and about how all of you made us more popular than Rooster Teeth.
Almost bigger than Jesus' podcast. Because as we all well know, Jesus would get flamed all over the internet.
Yes,
he
would.
Already covered that.
That's true. That was a while ago.
Yeah,
that was
well,
good times.
I'm going through every single episode checking its code. So I saw that and I was like, Jesus would totally get flamed all over. It's so insensitive and funny. Well, let's jump right in, hip deep into
let's
our
do
what's
it.
New. Pater, you go first.
Oh,
because your last
first.
Name is Brett and mine is Henry. So B goes first.
Oh, splendid. So, last time we podcasted from the end of the world, which didn't. So here we are now, and then Christmas was a thing, and I got myself some wheels, finally,
Woo!
So that's nice, driving around, get the car, and then instantly drive 120 miles in a day.
Let's put this fucker to the test.
Yeah, well, that's kind of how it went. It was mostly back and forth between fucking Vineland and Millville. The day started off like it would, like, car, yay, and then get the girl, then we're like, let's go to Bridgeton and visit people. Okay, so we do that. And that was fun. There were people. They got visited. And then we're going to a Christmassy party thing that night. So we get to the place, and it's like, well, we're going to pick up her bestest friend, the Gabberlion, who will eventually be on the show for our...
The Gabberlion?
He's a Gabberlion.
Yeah.
Okay, for those of us out there who don't know what that is, is that like a furry thing? Or?
Yeah. He's a furry. He's a lion.
Whoa, I totally guessed it.
Yeah.
Yep. I knew I was like, just double down, Carl. Pretend you know what it is and go, woo, furry.
And he produces Gabber music, and Gabber is his nickname. I've named
Okay,
him
now you've totally lost me. What is Gabber music?
I don't think anybody actually knows.
Gabber is an electronic music, and that's all I know.
Yeah,
oh.
it's
angry, happy, hardcore.
Yeah.
At the same time.
I guess. It's like if the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones made techno
music.
He
listens to it, and except I'm just no like, got punched in the face with noises. That's what
oh,
I feel.
Oh, great.
Yeah, it's a lot of really heavy four on the floor sort of happy electro.
Oh, like a Machines of Loving Grace kind of.
Sort of, except.
My Life with a Thrill Called Culty, but with on steroids.
Kind of more, there's nothing really mainstream to compare it to that Carl would also know.
Wow. You just said My Life with the Thrill Kill Cult was mainstream, Pete. That just shows how cool you are.
Yeah. It's of course. Well, I'm just trying to think of what you could compare it to. And
I mean, to be honest, I'm a terrible friend because I haven't actually listened to it. I just tried and it was noise. And I was like, okay, well, I'll share it. Maybe someone will like this.
Well, you know, that's almost as good.
It's kind of like hardcore. I don't know. It's a lot of.
It's like hardcore pornography, but if people were fucking with drum kits and drum
machines. Right. Well, it would be, but with a lot more distortion on the in the.
Well, you know what? That actually cleared it up for me. Thanks, Pete.
Yeah.
It really did. So I can picture it now in my head. Like.
Yeah. From what he was saying is that every kick drum tells a story. I'm like.
That story is.
I'm like, but at 140 BPM, that's a lot of kicks and that's a lot of stories going on. No wonder all your songs are 2.5 minutes long.
It's like the Gettysburg Address, but put to music.
Now that would be fun. Fans, get on that.
Full score. It's ready to go.
But so he was working that night, and it was like, well, we should go pick him up and bring him to the party. When's it get done? Like 11 o'clock. Okay, well, we can do that. We'll pick him up. So a little after 11 happens, and I'm like, ah, shit, it's a little after 11. Let's go get Gabber. So a bunch of us jump in a car, and we're like, wee, across back to from East Fuck Violent to Wendy's in Millville.
Oh.
Mm-mm. Or no, we went to his house, which is like
tried to.
3 blocks away from Wendy's, but it was like, where are we going? I don't know. It's over here. It's on this road. Okay, well, that road apparently goes in 3 different directions, and none of which are the ones that we went on. So after driving around the that sort of Foundry Street kind of, I think we're too white to be here area.
Ah, yes.
We finally found this stupid place, and then everybody's like, we all have to pee. So we go in there, and there's like people, and they're like, nope, no Gabber, he's still working. So we finally go to the Wendy's and the place, and he's like, no, I don't get done until 1:30. And we're like, all right, we'll come back, because he wouldn't just jump out the drive-through window.
We tried.
Just put a mannequin there.
So we go all the way back to East Fuck Vineland and party some more, and then go all the fuck the way back out to fucking Wendy's and get there a little before 1:30. But he doesn't actually get done till 2:15.
Wow, Gabber seems to have a lot of problem with time.
He was cleaning.
Yeah, I mean the fact he didn't get out exactly at 1:30 makes sense. I was just annoyed because I had to be driving back and forth instead of just staying in one spot drinking.
And drinking. I was about to say, yeah.
Because I was trying not to get too fucking drunk so I could actually drive successfully.
Yeah, so you wouldn't like lose your license in your car the very first night you got
exactly.
it.
Exactly. So we finally pick him up and we go all the way back to East Fuck Vineland and drink a bunch more and have a lot of fun. And then come all the way back to my house to pass out and everything. And so there, and that was ended up being a lot of fun despite my bitching at having to drive back and forth 100 times.
You got to drive. You got to go where you wanted to go, when you wanted to go, how you wanted to go, with whom you wanted to go with.
Yeah. That's sort awesome. Of, mostly.
Freedom!
Yeah. So that was good. And for those of you who are already wondering, it's a 94 Ford Escort wagon, 5-speed. So it's a family car that's fun to drive.
Whee!
And for being a 1994, it only had 111,000 miles on it to start with, which is pretty damn good.
Yeah.
And I got it from the mechanic who's done all the work to it. So.
Huh.
It, which is handy because he knows everything that is or was wrong with it, and if you know, like it's already due for an oil change, thanks mileage. But it just makes it easier because it's not like, oh well, I bring it to somebody who's never seen it before. It's like, no, I've been working on this car for
He's
years.
He's familiar with its ins and outs, its
so
bells and whistles.
That's handy. Christmas was pretty good. There was a lot of not as much driving around, but definitely a lot of fun with the Munchkin. Cass got him this Hot Wheels racetrack
loop
thing with those motors in it, so it slings the cars around these fucking loops, and you
really
press
cool.
a lever, and it goes around the rest of the crazy track.
It's pretty
and
cool.
So I put it together, and then he and I played with it for like 2 hours because he was just like he was trying to see how many cars he could put in the same loop, just being slung around after each other. And there's crashes and they're flying everywhere, and it was like way too much fun.
Yeah, just hearing about it, I'm like, man, I want to get one of those things. So
yeah,
cool.
it's pretty damn awesome.
Build stuff and then cars race around real fast and crash into shit. Yay!
Pretty much. That was awesome.
And by the time we got it home, it was in pieces again because I wanted to tape it and I was too lazy to tape it at the places where it connects. And Kyle just likes to step on the loop.
Oh, well, you can always tape it.
I mean, he is too, and he's just trying to get to where he can reach the cars, which involves stepping on the
fence. Yeah.
But again, it's designed for little kids. And that was one of the first things I did was like, okay, this is designed for little kids, but it's got spinny wheels and a motor. So I was thinking, how would I hurt myself on this? Well, I would stick my hand in the fucking motor. So
of course.
The first thing I did before I let him play with it was stick my hand in the motor when it was on.
Yeah.
But it's rubber, so it doesn't feel like anything. Huh. And as soon as you put any pressure on it, it just stops right away. So I'm like, okay, they designed it with little kids in mind.
Well, I hope so.
I don't know. I don't get to play with kids' toys.
Toy manufacturers, they don't last very long when their toys kill people or injure children. In fact, all it takes is really one, maybe two, and people are like, nah, it'd be safer to let them play with a real car on a real racetrack.
So that sounds pretty cool. And I got...
Peter got me a Dr. Hoosier, and I love it. And he didn't get the reference, but he got me the one with the silence lines. And it was like, oh, my God, silence lines.
Oh, the
like,
new Doctor Who.
Yeah, that's that shirt. He had many to pick from, but he picked a good one.
Yeah, the only one that was in a small, because they were all like boy sizes. There were no girl cut shirts. So I was like, well, I got to find the smallest one here. And it was one that said, you know, had the DW, like Doctor Who logo, and then a bunch of like hash mark things. And I'm like, I don't get it at all, but it's small and it's Doctor Who. So hopefully she'll like it.
I'm a big Doctor Who fan. Like, I grew up watching Tom Baker because he was God.
After the show, because I will take up this entire show talking about it. But, holla for the real old school Whovians. Yes. And that's not to say new Doctor Who fans are not real Doctor Who fans at all. I'm just saying, it takes a certain kind of fan to be into Doctor Who before he was sexy and cool and everyone on the planet was just like, look, I have a bow tie and a fez on, look.
Well, really upsets me because Netflix, when I had it a couple years ago, it had all the old, well, a lot of the old Doctor Who's on it. And I just corrupted my brother into watching it and he's addicted, of course.
Oh, yeah.
And he was like, well, I want to watch the old ones. I was like, they're on Netflix. He's like, no, I looked. I was like,
Netflix. Well, they are there because I saw that they had old ones when I got Netflix. I was like, yay. And they have some of them, but they have, I think, all of them, but with the DVDs, the DVD program thing they have. So I was like,
it's just not on streaming. Okay.
Yeah. Which I was like, no. So I'm in the process of trying to find a good deal because I have a couple of them on DVD. And I was just getting them free off the internet, but you get what you get. Usually broken up into parts on YouTube, or which is fine because you know when I originally watched them, it was like on Channel 23 on Saturday nights with the antennas. So you know I'm watching it. Somebody actually videotaped some of the Colin Baker episodes on a DVD player, just with the thing on it. At first I was like, whoa! But like once he got it lined up, within about 2 minutes. Totally didn't notice until he paused it because that was the end of that section and then put the other one. So I think it's really cool. Big ups to all the classic Doctor Who fans who are getting those episodes on the internet any way they possibly can.
I'm just really glad she liked the shirt because I didn't know what the fuck I was getting.
Good
purchase. I'm also glad that the shirt that I really wanted to get her, they didn't have in small because I told her about it and she was like, no, my brother has that shirt. I wouldn't have liked it as much. So yay,
Lady
Universe
Luck.
Helping us out once again.
See that?
And she got me probably the best, like most thoughtful, unique Christmas gift I've ever gotten.
Oh yeah, you're sure.
Because somehow, I mean, she and even her crazy pants mom came to the conclusion that I'm a classy guy, or at least trying to be more of a classy guy, which I am, and you know I'd like to be. So she gets me, like, she hands me this box, like, here, I got you this. This is your Christmas present that I wanted to get you, but because you're a dumbass and wanted to buy a car, we didn't have money last week. So I was like, all right, well, you know, at least we can drive around.
Well, yeah.
So she hands me this bag from Things Remembered, and I'm like,
okay,
the fuck? So I, you know, open up the thing, and I look at it, and it looks like it's like this box, and the top has this like silver bit on it. I'm thinking, oh, it's like a really swanky lighter or something. Yeah. I was thinking like Zippo type of thing, and it'll be engraved on the inside. So I open up the box, and I'm completely wrong. And it's like this super classy fucking pocket watch.
And you can see what time you're wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
Using the gift.
Oh, did you fix the time on it?
Yeah, I did. Oh, okay. I learned how to set it. So it's this like amazing pocket watch with a phrase in Gaelic on it, which I will look up the pronunciation eventually so I can actually say it. But what's it mean?
It means your heart is within me.
Yeah.
Oh,
which is an old Irish phrase of lovers.
Yeah, kind of very much the Gaelic.
As an old Irish man, two thumbs up. Very cool. Very cool.
Yeah, so she done good, and I'm wearing it right now.
It has gears on the inside that you can see.
And yeah, like the inside looks amazing. It's really awesome, and there's a space for a picture in there. And the stock picture, and this is what threw me off at first, like that stock sort of, here's the filler picture, is a guy with a goatee, like kissing a two-year-old-ish looking kid. And I'm like, how did she get a picture of me and her son doing this when I know this has never happened before? And then I looked closer and went, oh, he's not wearing glasses. Oh, that's not actually
just
me.
Just pencil in some glasses not her and you're son good.
I was like, yeah, I probably could just like, do glasses. Just leave that there. But yeah, it's I haven't really kind of been able to shut up about it. And I'm glad I have this sort of public forum to continue
what
to not shut up about
day.
Things.
That's right.
Now no one can shut us up.
So there's that. And then her mom is a bitch and kicked her out, so she's been staying with me, which has been kind of good. So we also...
Surprise! You get your girlfriend living with you for Christmas.
Well, I mean, that's fine. It's just I wish the circumstances were more under our control.
Yeah.
But...
sometimes you got to swing with the punches, man. You got to shoot and scoot.
So, and then on top of that, our job decided it was well too long for all of us to have actually been employed, so they laid us all off Friday, and
Merry Christmas, everybody. Go toddle off.
Yep.
The good news is they asked Peter to apply so that they have his information should they want him, which they do. They want him.
They do kind of want my junk.
Oh, well, that's awesome.
Yeah, and I go into the little foyer like there to fill out the app, and I go up to the secretary lady. I'm like, so, rumor has it, you guys want my information. And she's like, ugh, well, you're a little cocky, aren't you? And I'm like, wow, so you have no sense of humor. Check.
Or maybe she was getting laid off and they didn't want her information.
I guess. I don't know. But she's like bitchy McBitcher face all of a sudden. I was like, gee, let me fill this shit out then, you fucking bitch. Holy shit. All I'm saying is like, gee, I'm trying to be funny.
Sorry, I'm employable. And I'm happy about
it. This is why they sent me up here, because I'm kind of a fun, crazy guy, I guess. I don't know.
Nobody likes a grumpy Gus.
Right? For real. So.
Unless it's Tim. Then somehow there's magic involved.
Angry Tim works.
Well, that sounds like a pretty nifty altogether decent Christmas. I mean, you guys rolled with the punches for the little missus being vamoosified from her domicile.
Yeah, she was worried for a little bit, but I was like, nah, we got this.
Which is the power of two. Power of two. One is none. Two, good. Good, good, good. But,
the power of two will have to do. The power of two.
Because, and now the mom gets to experience the power of one. Yeah, she sounds like a big the power of negation kind of chick instead of the...
She's really going to regret it because it's going to like punch her in the face because she'll want things done or she'll expect certain things. And I'm just going to be, Mrs. Nope, it's not my problem anymore because I was all Miss Go-To family person. Like, I got things done. I helped out absolutely every way I could. And then I just kind of left because, she told me to. And
I was about to say, kind of left because she threw me out. And so that kind of puts a pall on that.
She's not going
to
get them. She's like not thinking of cause and effect. So this is
it's like, oh, hope she doesn't ever need us to babysit or help her do anything. It's not going to happen. And be like, oh, we got to pick up Kai. Done. No. Bella's your problem. Sorry.
Yeah, bye-bye now.
We're only taking care of her child.
Yeah, well...
You figure that problem, out your own kids, dummy.
That problem will sort itself out eventually. As long as you guys stay the course, I don't see any problems that you can't overcome.
That's what my dad was saying, too.
Two can handle anything. What? Yeah, your dad was so awesome with that real positive post on Facebook because I'm like, oh, all this negative stuff's going on. I felt bad because I'm like, Pete's actually, he's doing the right thing. Pete's doing the right thing, and he seems to be doing it with the right person because she makes him totally happy, and there's like this total positiveness. I don't know if you guys noticed, and out there in listener land, I'm sure, I don't know if you noticed, but the world is full of shit.
Yeah.
It's full of shit. That's the reason we make this podcast, is so that in this shitty shit world, when big dookies are falling to you from heaven, you're like, God, it's literally raining shit. This is awful. You think this is bad? There's a diarrhea front moving in later. Oh, God, no. Yeah, well, the clouds hung over KFC for too long. And, Hershey squirts. It's terrible. So, you need the little bits of positiveness, you know? It's you guys are trying to push some positive energy out. You're making a little spot in the world of shit, which isn't shit. And the thing that anyone would be like, ah, there's no shit there. Ah, and put more shit there like a fucking slee stack. It's just fucking ugh. Ugh. I always picture her as a slee stack. I don't know why. Just as big, bulky. Her whole body looks like it's a peg costume in Land of the Lost. Her eyes, the lids never close. Mouth full of fangs. Somehow pot belly, even though she's a lizard. It's just weird. And if anyone else is listening to you that's as old as I am and watched the original Land of the Lost, yeah, you know what the hell I'm talking about.
Yep.
But, yeah, well...
Well, Daddy's a really awesome person. He's not actually my father. I just kind of lived with my best friend in high school, and he was the crazy drunken guy in the basement. So
there you go.
So we'd go outside, and we'd have cigarettes, and we'd chit-chat, and he was like, you're awesome. I'm adopting you. And he's the father figure that has been there. After dating
everybody
my mom,
needs
he
one.
Still hangs out with me. So.
Well, there you go. Everybody needs one. And that's another fine example of somebody in a world of shit just pushing the shit aside. Move over, shit. Move over, shit. We're making a clean spot here. This is where we're going to live and think our thoughts. And
so he and Peter met on Christmas Eve? No.
Saturday before Christmas.
Well, they met and he gave him the daddy talk and he gave me the daddy talk. And
we met for the second time, which was kind of funny because the first time he was wasted.
Oh, so he met you first time sober.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, it's also been 2 years and change since that had happened.
Well,
yeah.
I brought a bottle to celebrate because I don't see my dad very often. So I brought a bottle of like some kind of apple-y.
It was like an apple cidery
whiskey
brandy, bourbon. I think.
Huh.
Yeah. And I was like, okay, so we're going to have the celebratory shots. And it turned into the celebratory drinking the whole bottle.
Yep.
Tell me you didn't see that coming.
Yeah,
I mean, come on.
Yeah, I should have guessed.
Yeah, well. Well, no, it was real positive to see someone from your family being positive to Pete because, I mean,
well,
God
that's
damn.
The thing is, and is like, you know, her sisters all think I'm cool and shit, and it's like everybody else is just like,
the
yeah,
cheese
my little
sister stands alone.
Like, hi, Pete, and there were hugs and stuff. And
the cheese stands alone in this one, and hi, Odario, the cheese stands alone. Fucking A. Well, that's not so bad. Sounds like a all in all decent little Christmassy thing.
Yeah, it's been pretty good. And then we went out last night to celebrate. Being unemployed.
Woo!
We have no money. Let's spend it all.
That's like a
pretty
giant
much.
Block party encompassing most of the country right now.
We're lucky enough that we have one more paycheck each coming to us this this week, and then we'll be sort of figuring
all
it out.
All the fun employment.
There. Yep.
But at least that
nice.
Lasts
yeah,
for
well,
like
she's got the good welfare action, so the state will help her out.
That's just tax. That's just your taxes returning back to you, Pete.
Yeah. Yeah, oh, no, that's fine. That's I don't all mind paying is. Taxes to help her get money to help us buy food.
I mean, it would be really great if you could have just kept that fucking money, because then you would have that fucking money. But whatever, it works out okay now, so fuck it. But, live a little bit and just keep your hearts and minds open, and the universe will just, something will just roll down your alley. You'll be like, oh.
I don't know. She's much better at being a good person than I am, but I think I'm much better at being positive than
this
she
is. This is a recent development, the good person thing.
That's why we usually have women in our lives to say the same thing about my wife. I'm like, she's so much a nicer person than I am. She's just so nice and so grown up. I'm so just fucking fucked up and odd.
But honey, why can't we go play in the leaves? You'll get sick and dog poop on you.
That's not so bad.
Anything to add? Or beautiful.
Well, Pete, I you weren't talking to me. Sorry.
God. Not really. I could rant about work and how I got really pissed off, and then pissed off about life.
This is an all right forum to do that in, but make it funny.
Yeah, as long as it's funny and short, that's all that ever matters.
So there's this guy
like a midget,
at work,
funny and short,
and he was only there for like a week or two before.
The recent unpleasantness.
Like sex with a clown, as long as it's funny and short.
Doesn't speak much English, but he talks. He's talked to me, and evidently he has a wife and kids in Puerto Rico, and he came here for blah de blah, like getting better opportunities. I'm like, okay. So he was a personal trainer up in Puerto Rico, and a very successful one. But coming to America, it doesn't translate. Like the certification, the licenses.
Oh, so he's got to get all that. It translates just fine. It's just the government's like, where's our take?
Yeah.
We want our part. Give us money, and we'll let you make money here.
So there he is, like, no family on Christmas because he's out here by himself, and people at work are making fun of him because he is built like a god with a small neck because he's a bodybuilder type dude.
Yeah, I mean,
and they make fun of
him. It doesn't make any sense because she's telling me this, and I'm like, so they're making fun of him because he's an attractive, healthy male
who misses his family,
yeah,
like,
and is trying to make it in America.
So they're
assholes.
They're basically mad because he's staying faithful to his wife even though she's in another. You know, she's like bajillions of miles away, and he is just fantastic looking. I talked to the dude. He's an intelligent guy, too. He's like...
Super intelligent.
He's one of these people that's like, I see something that I don't know anything about.
Tell me everything you know.
Right now. And I was like, oh, my boyfriend does that. And he was like, yeah, I'm learning Japanese. He's been trying to teach me Spanish. Well, was trying to teach me Spanish. And he was pulling a joke on me, and I was like, what the hell? That's not what that means. Because he was like, when you're very angry at your boyfriend, you have to say very angrily, what is it? Me tiene en cajones. And I was like, wait, that doesn't mean I'm very angry. That involves testicles.
Yeah. I know cajones. Everybody knows cajones. That's that. You know what? We all know what it is. It may as well be English because we all know.
Yeah.
We say it about balls more often than we say testicles, unless you're a doctor.
It's true.
And even some doctors, you know. Well, I received my degree in cajoniology and from the Institute of Cajoniology.
But that's a good example of me starting to be like a better person because I've been on the path of self-improvement since I was a bad, bad girl when I was a little.
Little?
Younger, you know, like a couple years ago and such.
Oh.
Bad person.
How old are you now?
I'm 25.
You are fucking younger.
Yes.
You're fucking younger. Don't yes like, oh, shoot, I feel validated. No, fuck that. That's the bullshit that 25-year-olds tell each other. I feel so old. Now you are, Mom. And that will eat
that
your soul.
Adds an extra
it does,
10 years.
But guess what? You could double it. You're still fucking older, younger. You're fucking young. You're 25. You're a fucking baby. Look, God, everything on your body fucking works. You asshole. Yeah. You can.
It does. I got to go to the bathroom for 5 minutes.
thinking of having sex. Was the sex with the clown joke too much for you, Pete?
Yeah, something like that. Hey, could you put on this red lipstick and this nose?
But yeah, you're like in the prime of your fucking existence.
Yeah, I'm just saying. 2 years ago, I was evil. Now I'm not so much.
Which is why I
still like being wicked. I mean, come on, I'm a Scorpio. Scorpios are naturally evil.
Every so often.
And I'm a not natural redhead.
I think there were three natural redheads on the planet.
Yeah.
The rest are girls who change their hair color to pretend it's red. It's like, why can't you just be yourselves?
Gingy?
No, my brother is dating one of them.
Oh, I thought you said my brother, as in my brother.
Oh, no. My brother, as in my brother, is dating a natural redhead.
Oh, well, that's one of them. That means there's one free-range redhead out there. Yeah. The rest are fucking fake. But, yeah, oh, you're 25. Enjoy it. Enjoy just waking up and being like, oh, energy.
Which maybe
just to fucking enjoy that feeling, all right?
Which may be news to most of our listeners because they're like, 25, that seems awfully old for Pete.
Yeah. But that's actually a perfect age. You've got 5 more years till you hit your sexual prime, for fuck's sake. Like, women in their 30s are supposed to be voracious. So, you haven't even, like, your sexual furnaces has just gotten lit up. So,
well,
Pete,
yeah, but that's Pete, because the past 2 years apparently have been pretty awful for her.
Oh.
So I'm just like, why she's all of a sudden, I don't remember her being this insatiable. I'm okay with this.
Well,
you know, but
Pete, tell me you're not complaining.
So I got to have sex with my girlfriend, like, every night. It's so terrible.
Oh, no.
She keeps on...
Never mind, that's going to be a little bit much.
Braveheart, Pater. Braveheart.
Fireballs from my eyes.
But no, there was a point where he was just like waking up or like he was getting ready for work and I just turned and like half awake. I'm like, sex now.
We'll see 25, ladies and gentlemen. 25.
Yeah, it's
the fact that you're able to roll over right after you woke up.
She's like never been into the whole morning sex type of thing. And then recently, like one day she woke me up, which is, I'm like, oh, that's okay.
That's always
good morning
the best.
To you too.
And for some reason, women always think that might be a problem. Like, I'm sorry I woke you up. It's like, no. It's like,
you woke me up with your hand around my dick. Yeah, that's fine.
That's always a win. You can't go. I had this conversation with my wife like a couple weeks ago and I'm like, dude, I could have an hour before work and I only have an hour to sleep. I could be 5 minutes into that sleep. You could be, can we fuck? I'd be like, yeah, yeah, sure. Right now. Go ahead. Just let me roll over. Oh. All right, I threw my hip out, but I don't need hips. I'm a guy. Let's do this.
Yep.
But
pretty much.
Yeah, when you get to be my age, you know when you see someone and they're bit by a zombie and they're dead and then they turn and they're all like, they're getting up and they're all slow and awkward. Their legs don't work right. It's not until they actually see prey that they are like, they get some. That's
you
a lot
know,
what it's
not
like.
Making me feel good about growing up.
Oh no, it's okay. Because guess what happens anyway?
Yeah, but
you're not
like
in the shit
years.
Zone though. Yeah, dude, when you're 25, a decade feels like 1,000 years from now. Don't worry.
I'm closer to zombiehood than you are.
Yeah, you're 25. You're just getting to know yourself and what you like, for
he
goodness
limping,
sake.
You know, coming to get me and limping, and I was like, hey, you're walking with a little bit of limp. Your knee's hurting you. And he's like, oh, I didn't think you noticed.
Yeah, I was trying
that's not
to be obvious about it.
Yeah, that's
well,
fine.
No, so, of course, that was the worst part about working with her. Is every now and then she'd just be like, she'd make one or two comments like right well before I end of work, and I'm like, now I gotta walk all funny because I fucking all excited here about what's gonna happen after work.
Oh,
and
yeah.
You leave an hour before I do. Thanks.
Yeah, I spent 2 days of my vacation in my pajamas. Yay. Which was awesome.
Life, yes.
But one thing about pajamas is, as a guy,
yeah, it's obvious.
It's so obvious. And which isn't bad if it's just the two of you, but if there's kids in the room, you sort of walk like, you know, the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Well, kids that
but
are
with the hunch in the wrong spot in the front, not the back.
Kids that are old enough to know, like, I could walk around with a hard on in front of her son and it wouldn't matter because he's fucking two.
Yeah, he's not gonna know anything. He's gonna be like, what's that, a toy in your pocket? It's not gonna connect.
Yeah, worse, like, it would be dangerous just because he'd probably try and punch it. Like,
oh,
what's that? Well, pow.
I can't tell you the amount of times I've had my nuts stomped by baby feet. It's ridiculous. Just mercilessly stomped like it was a trampoline to jump up to greater things.
I've seen this happen. Kairos jumping on him like a trampoline. I'm just like, cover your nuts. What the fuck are you doing?
Oh, dude, it's like,
as soon as a kid comes in the room, I'm like this.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's
a. Give you a hug. I'm like, all right. I feel like I'm catching a ball. You know, like, this is all right. Okay.
You're it's kind of here. A natural like dad reaction. It's like, a small kid going on the lap. We're good. Got this.
To the point where if I even like nap on the couch, I nap with like a pillow over my midsection. Because
hey, daddy.
Thump. Hey, dad. Ding Boom. Dong. I'm awake
that's
now.
That's not the happy waking up touch. Oh, go talk to your mom. No, actually, that's weird. Don't do that. If you ever wake me up like that, I'll kill myself.
No, usually it's just, Kim, take her. Kim, take her. Take her, Kim. Take her. And then they look all worried. I'm like, no, daddy's fine. It's all right. It's just a heart attack. But not my heart. It's my balls. It's a ball attack. Oh, God.
My left leg is gone numb.
It's like I have two heart attacks, two hearts between my legs and my scrotum. And you stepped on both of them. Oh, God. Except don't get the crash cart. Nothing about crashing near the balls.
Yes.
For God's sakes, the poor things.
We don't need to shock them back into rhythm. It's fine.
It'd be like taking like a veteran of six wars to Zumba. At the gym. you don't want to do that. No, they've been through enough, for Pete's sake. Just let them grow old with dignity. Like there's anything dignified about balls. But
not really.
Oh, that note.
So how is your what's new?
Speaking of dignity of balls, you know, it really wasn't that bad. We had our podcast, which was super awesome.
He winked at me.
Oh.
Oh, I love you. Oh, it's great. We're going to get our cuteness all over the show now, too.
That's okay.
Fans of our Facebook pages and the show are going to be like, oh, these two just never fucking stop. God, they're so gross.
But
sorry, wait for the That's Life sex tape.
We did our... Oh, man. We did
That's going to mess with Carl for a little bit.
Well, I was just thinking of...
Because it's like I would have to hold the camera, wouldn't I? No, it's not bad.
That's Life sex tape with Carl. Why is it? It's just like a shot from behind, and he's sitting in front of a computer. I don't get it. Oh no! Oh no! Oh no!
I was reaching for the Kleenex.
Oh God! Let me fast forward. Well,
wait! Is that a cheetah?
Oh wait, it's over. Well, that wasn't so bad. Now he's fixing his sandwich. Say, oh, that's not mayonnaise. No, no!
Oh, he could at least wash his hands first.
I need to get a drink of water for that.
Yep.
But we did our podcast at the end of the world. That was cool.
And it was funny because that episode almost didn't happen that night because I was like, man, I got to get up early and blah, blah, blah. And we're driving in. And Cass, bless her heart, was just like, The world's supposed to end tonight. Why aren't you podcasting? Oh, fuck. Well, it doesn't matter if I don't get any
sleep. Thank you.
We have to record it live.
You're his personal assistant. That's great.
So, yeah, that happened pretty much thanks to her. Yay. Let's do it Friday night.
But, you know, so we had that. Now, that was cool. I got that posted. Some good thumbs up about it.
Awesome.
if you haven't listened to it, listen to it, because it has a new Christmassy beginning, which I'm all proud of and shit.
Yeah, because if you're listening to this and you haven't listened to the previous episode,
what the fuck? Well, maybe they want to listen to it in reverse order, because they saw the day they were on it. Or who knows. But, so recorded that, and, you know, I did some, I got most of my Christmas shopping actually done well before Christmas.
Oh, nice.
So,
I still have Christmas shopping to do.
Oh, boy.
Gotta get Kairos this mixer thing. It's fucking awesome.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, it's going to be great. I can't wait to play. I mean, yeah, it's for him to play.
But I wanted to go out and do some of that. I had to go to Atlanta County, and it was supposed to be, it was my sister's birthday. She's born on the 23rd. Ugh. So we were like, hey, why don't we just exchange gifts on that day? Much easier. So we're going to go, and we're going to have dinner at Olive Garden. And my wife's like, yay, Olive Garden. Oh, I love Olive Garden. And then, of course, what'd you say? We can't hear you out there.
Olive Garden's the way to the vagina.
There you go. Hallelujah.
I can make Toscana soup.
Yo. Yeah, have you had the Zuppa Toscana from there?
I have not had any of the Zuppa Pizzagata.
It's that potato, sausage, creamy, potato Italian soup.
Oh, yeah. You know, my brother-in-law had gotten that, and I was like, oh, I wish I could smell, because I bet that smells delicious.
Well, she learned how to make it, and it's better than the restaurant.
Sweet
it's
home
so
Alabama.
So good.
Well, that sounds fucking super. You put the recipe onto the Facebook for me so I could snatch that, spread the love. So the four-year-old, of course, who we thought was over a stomach virus, not so much. Threw up all over the couch, all over the floor. So my wife stayed home with her, and I went with my oldest, Jenna.
Speaking of your family, we saw Rossi in Walmart the other day.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah.
Just,
and I was like,
stuff,
that's our pocket Viking.
Yeah. Oh, dude, Ross is awesome.
Sorry.
Anyway. Hear about my exciting present from him. So went there, exchanged gifts and everything. And I'm like, wow, I can't believe I'm dodging the stomach virus. This is great. And then Christmas Eve, I like to go to the mall because I like the Christmas Eve chaos.
Yeah, he's a fucking glutton for punishment.
I'm weird like that.
I like you.
I love it because you get the Christmas, everyone's moving around and buying stuff and everything. And I like to do stuff like let people go first in line, or do stuff like when I'm parked, you know, you're at a four-way stop and someone, or someone's been trying to back out of a spot and everyone's like, fuck you, fuck you. I'm like, I'll flash my lights and let them pull out of the spot, even though someone else got it. Or if like me and someone else are vying for a spot, if it's a dame, I let her take the spot and I just drive on.
Just making the day a little bit better.
Just a little bit.
That's what I thought about when I was working at Toys R Us. All these people are so angry and you just got to give them a good thing. So I just made sure I super smiled and was like, I hope you have a good day with sincereness.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's the one time when the human race, most of us, stops being fucking assholes or just dials down the asshole a little bit. So, you know, I'm ready to go enjoy that. And then
I gotta avoid those situations because my asshole gets turned up. What? Good job, brain. Way to phrase that poorly.
Hey, guys, whoa. Some stuff you can't say on the podcast. I don't care what she does to your asshole, Pete.
No, not much. We kind of stay away from the booty holes.
Well, it's a good idea. I mean,
you the should. Holes. Sometimes I'll threaten because it's hilarious. Oh, I'm sticking in. Boom. Ow, my eye. Oh.
Okay.
You couldn't just... Oh,
when this bruise clears up, I'll try again. But... Because I don't know why you just have to, like Christopher Columbus, just unexplored country, you just have to, oops, no, it's the angry dolphin. no more.
Almost,
can't put it in the blowhole, no sir.
Who is it? It was Adam, this guy Adam, we can credit with telling us about the angry werewolf.
The angry werewolf?
Okay. Yes. It's, apparently what you do is you shave off all your pubes, but you save them, right? So... That's just step one. So
Jesus, it's already.
This is very close to the Spider-Man.
And
so apparently, what you do is you come in the girl's face and then you throw the pubes at her face so they stick, and then she gets mad,
and then she never has sex with you again.
Yeah, pretty much.
But she looks like Benicio del Toro in fucking. Son of a bitch. So
and it's just as unintelligible as him from Usual Suspects.
Wow, and your eyes are all glued shut. She can't see anything. She got Groucho Mark eyebrows now. It's fucking awful. She looks like she got a Hungarian unibrow. It's like, oh wow,
gross.
It's like, Spider-Man, you look like a Romanian female gymnast. Look at you. But
it's so great, except for the head.
Well, yeah. But you just got a head, so everything's great.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm running around, then all of a sudden I feel it's like... I'm like, what? I didn't eat anything. I specifically didn't... I had like a saltine cracker because I knew I didn't want to have anything going well. I'm like, oh... No. Then I got the worried dolphin. No. Went back to car, went home, and I'm like, no. Why, God? So chilled at home. And then all Christmas, you know, got up nice and early. I think it was like 5:30 in the morning. And I'm
glad I avoided that.
Oh, yeah. It's just, yeah, I don't mind, though, because they're going to be older one day, and I'm going to be like, I missed that. So I'm like, well, I might as well suffer through it now. So later I go, oh, I missed. No, I didn't.
I'm going to train Kairos to wake up at like eight. Go ahead and think that.
Just let that in your brain because it's not going to happen. Because they were up before five.
Oh, I'm sure. Oh. Well, I remember being that little and being like, well, like because the way we did stockings back when I was young is instead of, you know, how some people like you hang them on the mantelpiece or like stockings are hung up somewhere, we'd have them at like the end of our beds or like in the room somewhere. And then in the middle of the night, the parents would sneak in and take
the stuff
and
put
them back. So it got to the point where I don't know about my little brothers because we all had our own rooms. But for me, I'd be like, I'd catch them sleep a little bit, but be awake enough so that way when the parental units would come in to steal the stockings, I'd be like, all right. Okay, they took it. The coolness is coming. I'm going to wait a little bit, and they're going to put it back. And as soon as that happens, I'll wait like 5 more minutes, and I'm going to turn on a light, and I'm going to go through that shit and eat a shit ton of candy and play with whatever fucking toys are in there until it's acceptable enough for me to kick them awake.
I'll sit here for 4 hours just fantasizing about the fucking gifts.
Yeah, that's pretty much how that went. Yeah. So I don't, I definitely don't blame any kids for
I totally don't. The littlest one got up, woke up the biggest one. They snuck out staring at the presents, just staring at them.
Goes, yep.
Each of them tried to work up the courage to either wake us up or open them, realizing they couldn't, and that turned into excited energy, which kept them awake longer. Which is fine, because that's the whole point of the thing.
Well, her crazy pants mom, and I hope that we can avoid this tradition, has this crazy ass tradition of staying up all
throwing
night.
Her children out of the house for Christmas. Great tradition.
But it's before that, it's staying up all night with the children that are getting thrown out of the house, wrapping all the fucking presents and not getting any sleep. And I'm like, that seems awfully retarded.
And
you know,
that does not sound
and
like.
And then
the
her
70s.
Brother has a crazy tradition of showing up at 6 a.m. drunk as shit, jumping on everybody, waking them all up. That's which is kind crazy. Of a funnier tradition, except that I was drinking the one year we did spend Christmas together at her crazy pants mom's place. Is I was up till about 2 something in the morning drinking wrapping presents, and then I was like, "Well,
you were
I
drinking
need, like,
wrapping presents." Sounds like a crazy liquor that only sells once a year.
So good, it's some kind of vodka, I think. And so then, you know, the crazy drunk brother comes home and jumps on me, and it's just like, "Hey, it's time for presents!"
It's like, get off me, Barney.
Still drinking, and he lasts for about till 7 a.m. throwing presents at people, going, all right!
Aggressively throwing.
And now, Jesus Christ. Which is hilarious, and one of those things that'd be great to watch on YouTube, because he promptly passes the fuck out at once all the presents are thrown. Yeah. So good.
What's nice, you managed to turn a domestic incident into something, you know, funny and positive. That's good.
That's why we do the show.
Because usually a drunk son coming into your house, rampaging and throwing presents is a bad thing.
No, this is usually, this happened to be hilarious.
Oh, okay, well, that's good. So Christmas, sheer force of will is holding my innards together. I felt like I was a half-embalmed mummy. And I was just like,
that happens to you at least once a month. I mean, don't you have stock in Imodium?
It's the gay period. That's what I call it. It's the gay period. Anytime a guy comes on to me, or if I'm like talking to a girl and she might like actually be a little too flirty, I just mention the words gay period. And that just hits the sexual e-stop. And I'm like, all right, back to zero. Good. We can be friends again. That's nice. But,
When you're done, remind me of a good sexual.
Not my homosexual period, or
no. I have a sexual e-stop scenario occurred recently.
So. Oh yeah,
yeah. Oh, remind yeah. me. I needed to talk
you
about
don't need
that
to
on
remind
the show.
Him, really, because I'd like to have sex again.
That's hilarious.
But let's say, I'm getting through the day. Got cool presents. My wife got me a TARDIS salt shaker.
Nice.
Awesome. A Dalek Pepper Pot.
That's great.
Which is what they used to call them in the 60s. They called them Pepper Pots with plungers on it. That's what they. That was like the joke back in the day. So I was like, oh, I can't believe you knew that, how you actually listened to my geekness. And got some a couple cool shirts. And I got an awesome robe from my wife. It's a Sith sorcerer robe. It's all black with a hood.
Oh, yeah.
And it's, dude, it's quality. I first saw it in a magazine. She'll show me. I'm like, oh, that's fucking awesome. And I'm like, well, I couldn't feel the fabric. I didn't know if it was what I like. I'm like, that's probably real cheap or something. No, dude, it's like 100% quality. Like, Emperor City is fucking quality.
Nice.
And the hood, it's
like, you could rub your old wrinkly Emperor balls in it.
Yeah, dude. Oh, it's fucking great. So I got that.
Force lightning in this any day.
And it's just fucking cool as hell.
So I really like that.
Got awesome. Some other gifts.
Oh, yeah. Along those same lines, this lovely woman sitting to my left bought new fucking sheets for my bed. Some like really swanky black like microfiber type things.
Oh,
so comfortable. Puppy?
Oh, yeah.
So good. Puppy's and, so of good. Course, I didn't put them on the bed until she was staying over. So I was like, we got to test them out together.
Yeah, break them in, of course.
Pop you need cherry. Washed already, but hey, that's okay.
Well, yeah, you know, it happens. But let's see.
Yes.
Then I got, I think, one of the coolest gifts I got, aside from that, of course, I got a full ballistic body armor.
Oh, cool.
Which I've totally been needing because offensively, I'm you know. I'm a plus 10 for offense, but I'm a zero for defense. Cloth armor, not so good. Ballistic body armor, very nice. So someone could shoot me with a fucking slug from a shotgun, like from across the room.
And you'd be bruised and uncomfortable?
I would be hurt so bad, but I would be dead. Someone could pepper me with 9mm, 40 fucking millimeter. It doesn't matter. Just... like pink, 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 pink. I could fall down like I'm dead. Do that shoot him thing like the Terminator, which is really cool. I got an awesome, really well balanced blade, not just for stabbing, but in the way it's that the sheath and everything is, it hooks right into your web gear.
Oh,
and I was I had like a really cool machete mm-hmm. for the full tactical web gear. But this is a little bit shorter, so it's easier to... Because, you know, well, I have the three-point sling, which puts the... you know, in Generation Kill, how they always held their fucking M16s yeah. right on their chest? They could just put their hand on the hand grip, and just it would just stay there?
Right.
That's the three-point sling. I love the three-point sling. And so now I have that, so I can put it anywhere. I can slip it, like, in the front, so when you get it, you don't have to go like this. You can just go, shink, and pull it out.
No, very nice.
So very cool. Very happy
along
about
those
that.
Lines, you have an AR-15, yeah?
No. No, AR-15s are a lot like M16s in that they must be cleaned constantly or they jam their pains in the butt. I have a very rare, by comparison anyway, M18, which is a lot like the a lot like the AR-15 and the M16, except it doesn't shit where it eats. It uses a system of pistons as opposed to using just a discharge gases to come all the way back to push all the shit back. Because that's what would get them dirty.
Yeah.
All that, because you dirty dirt air with fucking residue and shit in there.
My question about the AR-15 is that it's, from what I understand, kind of the civilian flavor of the M16.
Yeah,
right?
it's
so it's not like an M4?
No, it's semi-auto. That's okay. All. It's semi-auto.
See, told you that bitch was full of shit.
She's a crazy bitch, and I hope she dies.
Which
somebody was
bitch?
Trying to tell me that the AR-15 was the was an M4.
No, it is not. Not. I wish because I would get one because M4s are pretty neat.
Yeah, well, M4s are way better than M16s.
Well, the M4s, they get the shorter barrel.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just like they don't.
The longer the barrel, though, the better your accuracy.
And less jamming.
No, not necessarily.
Really? I always thought M4s were just better.
Well,
for that reason.
Well, it depends on
the carbine.
Carbine means all carbine means is that it uses handgun bullets.
Oh,
so that's
I don't know, but all I know, but what I did know was that the AR-15 wasn't
but
much of an M4.
Yeah, totally not that. But yeah, so I was all pumped up about that.
Sweet.
Let's see what happened. Wife and I got late. That was awesome. I got some pussy.
Oh, yeah? Oh, I was about to say, separately or together?
Together.
We each got some ass. It was great.
Which made it even better. Yay. Much less awkward. Yay.
So yeah, I didn't get any, like, Christmas Eve poontang, but
Christmas oh, no, it wasn't Christmas night. Eve. Christmas Eve, oh, even Christmas yeah. night, it's like,
I got to unwrap the best present of them all.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I planned on getting this big ribbon from Spencer's. There was a ribbon, but it went, and yeah. And I didn't do it because we bought a car. Because yeah. he said he wanted all he wanted for Christmas was some strategically placed bows.
Oh.
Yeah, to unwrap the best present ever. Well, but, yeah. you know, it's
what? The present's still there.
The car was kind of more important.
Yeah.
And I got the most thoughtful present instead and yeah. still got to unwrap the
it
best
totally
present.
It totally works
ever.
Out. So that was pretty cool. Let's see what else. Do. Yeah, that's it. Lots of time with, spent a full day with both my nieces and my youngest.
Awesome.
From like 8 till about 4:30, and then it was just me and the baby until she'll always be a baby. She'll be 30, and she'll still be the baby.
Right.
You baby, big, big. She's a wee little big, big. She'll be 30. Dad, stop.
Damn it, Dad, I'm married. Knock that shit off.
Oh, you're still my little big, big. You're going to be tootie, 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 tootie. But
why can't you just kick me out of the house on Christmas like normal people?
Because I'm an asshole. Because I'm a fucking parent. And you're not a boy, so boys, you have to kick him out of the ass, out of the house.
You
sometimes.
Have to kick him out of the asshole. It's just
boys are born out of the ass. Everybody knows that. That's just how it works. That's why we are as shitty as we are. That's why we're always trying to get back in. So you know, we're dumb. We all know it's warm. It's moist. It's dark. My dick can't see what it's doing. Don't blame me. Blame the penis. Good luck with that. I've been blaming it for shit for years. So yeah, all in all, it was a very satisfactory holiday for me as well. Oh, the results came back from my blood works
for the sinuses
for all that. Yeah, and he said he's like, okay, most people who have like normal, most people are at 30. A bad allergy tax is like about 50 or 60. You're at 135. That probably explains, you must feel, I'm like, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I feel like I'm dying all the time. Like,
I kind of feel about as terrible as your arbitrary scale says I should.
Yeah, my body feels like it's fighting off Ebola at all times. So I got the test. We got the allergy test to find out what I'm allergic to. Ah. And all this time, I've been giving my wife shit because I'm like, it's that fucking cat. I know it's the cat. It's the fucking cat. I know it's the cat. Not the cat at all. Nothing. Zero of the cat. Totally not allergic to cats. In the slightest. And I was like, are you sure? He's like, I'm pretty sure I'm reading the number zero correctly. Like, we could run another test if you're really sure. But I was like, well, you're probably way surer than I'm sure because my sure is based on bullshit I pulled out of my ass. Your sure is based on science. So, you know. So I had to come home and tell my wife that, who's been telling me for years it's not the cat. So
only imagine her vindication.
That was my Christmas present to her.
So we're getting another cat. God damn it.
Honey, you're so fucking right. And I was so fucking wrong.
They do love to hear that.
I wonder if that's where the sex came from. But anyway.
Say it again, baby.
You were right. You were,
shit. Yes. I was right. You'll be right an awful lot. You'll be right in the middle of the night. Honey, look, my right-o-meters, it's ding dong. Time to wake
max.
Up. So
pick a fight, and you know you're wrong, but you just got to tell her that she's right.
Well, I got to do that anyway. But it'd be nice to get sex out of the deal.
That's just general rules. I know this bitch yeah. is fucking wrong, but whatever you say, baby, you're so right.
It's yeah,
right.
It's just safer that way. It's a lot quieter, too.
Very good. But, I'll fix the fallout later. Just you are so right. And whatever
I made my dad laugh about that once because my mom was arguing with me about something. Not like seriously arguing, but... And then I said, oh, no, you're totally right. She goes, see, why can't you... She goes, see, our son agrees with me. I go, yeah, of course. It's quieter that way. My dad started laughing. He thought that was fucking hilarious. My timing was... You ever have those moments where you get a joke off and the delivery's perfect, the timing's excellent, and you're like, I could do this for a living. I used to do that all the time.
When we were hanging out with her daddy... she posted on Facebook that we were over there, and some like mutual friend of theirs who hasn't seen him in a while said something, and she read it out loud. And her dad was an English major in college, so the guy was like, "Oh, where are you guys at?" And I was like, "Same place as your preposition." And
zig.
He about pissed himself, and I was yeah. like, "Yes, he got the joke." And he said, "You know, your timing was perfect."
Yes. Oh,
so,
shit.
Yes, very much feeling you on that one.
Yeah, it was a really positive. It'll be a really good thing, you know. Wife and I get along so super awesome. That makes me happy. Because, like, when you're
it's
married...
It's nothing better, man.
Yeah, dude, when you're married... I see so many marriages where they just bicker and fight all the time. And I'm just like, that's so terrible. Yeah, that's the person you're with till you die, you know? And it's such an unnatural state for my wife and I to be like that. But it's just like everything's been super, super duper. And when that's fucked up, it's like my whole world is just off.
Yeah.
I wake up in the morning, it's like there's a fucking just an asshole sitting in the bed with me going, you ready to start your day? Because anything you might feel good about, I'm just going to shit on.
Hey, that's my mom.
And what?
It's like there's a spiritual version of your mom just following me around, just shitting on my riff.
And that's what sucked so recently the past couple of weeks is, I mean, especially there was one week when every fucking day, because it's like you're saying, you know, if she's not happy, then the day's just...
It's wrong. It's the world's just not right till that's straight.
And I had to see her... Like, I had to see her every single fucking morning with her fucking smile removed because
of
some
like shit.
No, completely and what she'd do is she'd drive me to work, and then she'd wait until we were almost there. We were on Garden Road, and then she'd start bitching, and it just ruined my day. I started out super happy. I was like, yeah, I texted him. I was happy by the time I walked into the door.
Because she saw you were happy.
Yeah.
I knew that you were going to be away from her and had to ruin it.
Like, you know, because I'd be like, I do that thing that boyfriends are supposed to do, and actually because I actually genuinely like to say, you know, good morning, beautiful.
Yeah, a nice little positive thing to start your day with.
Exactly. And
women love the good morning text.
And the first thing, and it's like I knew it was going
to
be
you live together now, so that's even better. You get to do the good morning kiss and hug and stuff.
Yeah, but like she texts back already pissed. I'm like, I want to fucking stab people.
Exactly.
And it
sucks.
It's anytime that she starts the day and I know she starts the day happy and there's a smile there, if it doesn't matter the reason it gets removed. And it's only been my fault once, but I fixed it. You know, but like, it's just like, I want to fucking murder people because, like,
him and this other guy in the packing line were mad because I started the day, I was super bubbly dancing around work. And then I heard people talking shit about the guy and I was instantly pissed off and he saw that I was pissed off.
Yeah, like I was like, who should I shank? Like, how many bodies do you want me to pile up? Because nobody should be removing your smile from your face.
Yeah, who has done this to the woman I love? They should be slain.
Pretty much. And then I talked to the other guy, and I was like, I'm about to fucking start shanking niggas left and right. And he goes, sign me the fuck up, because I'm just feeling that too, man. We'll fucking do it.
Let's do this. Yeah.
So I was like, all right. And I started getting pumped, and then I kept on. I talked to her friend. I reminded myself. Summer, and I'll tell you this story to tell you another story, because this chick Summer looked a little upset, and I was like, somebody upset you too? Let's go. Tell me who it is. I'll fucking start killing motherfuckers.
We're forming a committee. We're getting this shit sorted out today. So here, fill out this form and come and state your grievance. We'll sort this shit out.
So speaking of that.
7 days to a week.
When we had jobs and we're working together, like, you know, 2 days ago, I would walk with her when they were going on break because we went on breaks separately from each other, so I would wait to either refill my water bottle or use the bathroom until they were going so I could walk with them and not get anybody in trouble, which pissed her supervisor off even more because he had no reason to get us in trouble, though he wanted to.
So, got to the point where his boss was like, please, Peter's boss was like, please stop making him call me.
Yeah, like my boss who loves me was just like, he's being obnoxious. And I don't care what y'all do because it's cute and you guys are both good at your job.
Yeah.
But
happy employees are productive employees.
Yeah. But so I'm walking with her and her friend, this chick, Summer, and we're walking and she had gotten bubbly and happy again. And she turns to me and she says, so what would you do if we were having sex and I started calling out Summer's name in bed? And I look over at Summer and she was to her that like sort of your girl wants to fuck me face. And I'm like, well,
really,
I know that's
really
not going to happen because you're kind of skanky, but it was still kind of early because it was their first break and my brain was like, I got nothing, dude. I don't know.
I don't know. Bust my
nut.
So
I said, I'd probably come up with something funny. I'll get back to you on that.
Yeah.
And as soon as they like walked around the corner away and my brain went, here is your answer. And it's like, thank you, brain. But now we have to wait.
Yes.
Fortunately, it was a 15-minute break and I didn't forget. So so they come back around.
He's trying to get.
I'm doing too much at once.
Making a very good effort at it, by the way.
Wait, no, you don't need the cap. You need the beer. There we go.
Okay.
She has a hat. Back, she doesn't need the cap.
So they come back around, and she's walking with Summer, which is good because I needed them both there to make the full effect of the joke work.
I've got this funny, this little gem I have here. I've been nursing it.
And she walks up to me, she's all like, smile, like, hey, baby. And I'm like, hey, so do you want to know how I know you'll never call out Summer's name in bed ever? And she goes, okay, how? And I said, well, sticking with the theme of seasons of the year,
uh-huh,
you call out Summer I'll call out Autumn. And her look of horror was fucking priceless. And now Summer had that look you're giving me now. That's sort of, why is that significant?
Yeah.
So I turned to Summer and I said, Autumn is her 17-year-old sister's name.
Well played, Peter. Well played.
And then even Summer was like, oh, that is so fucked up. Yeah. I was like, well, that's what happens when you let my fucked up brain sit on something for 15 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen, now that's a sexual e-stop.
Yes. And
at least for her. Then you get to do Bucking Bronco. Hang on until you're done. No, get the fuck off me. I will. I am. I'm trying.
So you might want to plug your ears for this, but I was telling a story to somebody else, and I was like, at least I didn't finish my entire thought. And this person goes, wait, there's more to this thought? I'm like, well, yeah, because you know how timing is everything? See, if she called out Summer, I'd call out Autumn right as I was coming.
Oh.
And it would just be like, but I want to have sex again. So,
yeah.
You know.
And your penis intact.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That's
better enjoy that orgasm. Maybe your last.
You don't want the hammerhead penis.
No, you don't want to get the hammerhead
snap
penis.
Snap dick is bad.
Snap dick. Oh. You know, it sounds like a something that will be on one of those infomercials. Like, oh no, my penis is leaking again. Use a new snap dick. It's a snap. Getting your penis erect is difficult. Sometimes can take hours. You can get carpal tunnel. Ow! Oh no! Now use the snap dick. It's ready in a jiffy. penis leaking. Okay.
I think it's almost as bad as anal leakage.
Yeah, that is pretty bad. Yeah. But I got medicine for the allergies.
Oh, right, that is what we were talking about.
Oh, I was almost done. I got medicine for a new nasal spray, which doesn't really mostly. It doesn't work like the Afrin, but Afrin has like all these other things about Afrin that you know. Once you do it, start using Afrin, you have
it
to keep
works
using
less
Afrin.
And less and less and less. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's where I was getting it. My allergies were getting worse and worse and worse. So
what were you allergic to?
Dust. A dust mite, shit like that.
Oh.
And Bermuda grass, Bermuda green grass.
Huh.
Yeah.
All that.
Well,
Bermuda.
Stay away from Bermuda.
Yeah.
Well, it's probably like dust. I'm going to have to change the filters in the heating unit and stuff and just like dust the house some more and shit like that.
Gotcha. Well, just try not to blow your arm up again.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. No, there's no fire involved with changing the filters on this. That was awful. But speaking of fires, not really. We have our new segment here for the end of the year.
Good job, segue.
good job, awkward segue for our failed predictions. I went and scoured the internet for like 2 hours because this actually took a while to find ones that were both predictions and interesting.
Yes. Because some predictions that don't work are just like, okay, well, yeah, it didn't turn Thursday on a Wednesday.
Yeah, so they'll start making roofing nails out of cotton candy. No, they won't. Okay. So, but that's not, I mean, that is kind of funny, but, you know, it had
delicious.
Something that made sort of sense, or at least we could twist it that way. This next one was from 1986.
This is the first one.
The first one was the roofing nails made of
cotton candy. Oh, gotcha. Right, so. You were born in 87?
Jesus fucking Christ.
Even I feel old.
Yeah. You know, I was just rocking out to some fucking Judas Priest when they were playing live in 1986, the year before you were born, by the way.
I like them young.
Which,
what
by the
I
way,
say?
I went to the Ozfest where Ozzy got bronchitis, and the guy from Judas Priest filled in for him. Sounded just like Ozzy. It was awesome.
Rob Halford?
Sure.
Rob Halford.
Did he have blonde hair?
Was he gay as shit and spikes on his?
Yes.
That's Rob Halford.
That's Halford, all right.
I know. If it was leopard print leotards with a big push brew mustache and giant teeth, we know Freddie Mercury gay.
Yes.
If it's spiked collars, handcuffs, a whip, drives out in leather on a Harley Davidson on the stage with blonde hair, then we know it's Rob fucking Halford. You fucking rule. All right, this next one, this first one's from 1986. There was a scientist, Professor Watson, in Washington, D.C. He was talking about a dramatic loss of ozone over Antarctica, proving that the greenhouse effect is real.
Right.
And there will be a gradual warming of the Earth that threatens floods, drought, and human misery in a few decades. And if not checked, it will, in a few decades, lead to the eventual extinction of the human species.
Yeah, they've been talking about that forever.
Yeah, I remember hearing about that.
Since then, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Actually, he said since 1974.
Yep.
And the temperature around the world will have risen 10 degrees, all life as we know it should be dead by now. So that one was just a little bit off.
Just a touch.
Just a little bit. There was another graph put out by a scientist from NASA about the greenhouse effect stuff. It said by 2012, sea surface heights... now, they spiked in the year 2000 to 30 feet above sea level.
Okay.
They came down a little bit to about 25 feet above sea level in 2012. So I don't know if you've been to the sea... But it's not.
But it certainly came up on the shore here.
Well, yeah, that's what happens when there's actual force working on it. But,
yeah.
But it didn't stay that way. It went away eventually.
Yeah.
Another guy. This guy was a Hansen, Professor Hansen.
Not that.
From 1986. So you know, they were probably born before your girlfriend.
One of them, maybe.
Yeah, that Earth, he predicted Earth will be a living hell by 2001, and it will be Ronald Reagan's fault.
Ah, well, it's not Reagan's fault, but, you know.
Yeah, and it really wasn't a living hell by 2000. In fact, 2001 really wasn't so bad,
actually. No, not
actually.
Too much. And what's funny is, like, speaking of living hells and all this stuff, like, oh, school shootings and things are so terrible. Everybody's always, like, freaking out about this, that, the other thing, and Obama's the devil, and things are so terrible. If you really actually, you know, take your time and not be inundated by media and look at stuff... The world today is safer and better, like, than it's ever been.
Depending on where you're at.
Right.
But yes.
Well, but still, but those, like, even those little, like, Syria and those type of places, certain places are fucking terrible.
Yeah, back in the day, there was no place where you couldn't be raped, sold,
yeah.
Or stabbed at the drop of a hat.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's progress. Is there more to do? Sure, there's plenty more to do.
Yeah.
But we are working on it.
Right.
Some of us. Let's see, another prediction.
Fuck.
By May of 2004, this was from the UK's top scientist at the time. He said...
Just, that's the title, Sir Top Scientist.
Sir Top Scientist-y guy. Antarctica is likely to be the world's only habitable continent by the end of this century. So by 2000, the only place we would be able to be living would be Antarctica.
Well, slightly off there.
Slightly off? By maybe a few thousand years.
Yeah.
Better luck next thousand. this is Thomas Watson, the chairman of IBM in 1943. I think there is a world market for maybe 5 computers. Not exactly a Nostradamus, that guy.
No. considering the computers in my pocket for my phone are smarter than the ones we put on fucking Mars.
Oh, yes. Dr. Peter Duisberg, a molecular biology professor at Berkeley in 1988, said, that virus, HIV, is a pussycat. Boy, was he way wrong.
Well, at this point, there's enough medication and advances in science where it's not a death sentence anymore.
It's just a sexual death sentence.
It just
unless you're
sucks.
Fucking other guys, girls with the AIDS
yeah.
virus. Just still, it's not a lot of fun to have, though.
No.
When
oh,
a
no.
very difficult to manufacture and expensive cocktail of pharmaceuticals are the only thing keeping you alive, it sucks. This next was put out by the New York Times in 1936.
Okay.
It said, a rocket will never be able to leave the Earth's atmosphere.
Yep.
Might
never
have been a little
happen.
Off. A little off. Dr. Dionysus Larder, which is a crazy mix of names.
Yeah, kind of
awesome. Dionysus, Greek mythology. Person.
Yes, actually. And there were the mysterious rites of Dionysus, actually, which people still don't know exactly what it was about, but they said it was it's a crazy thing involving women. I haven't delved. It's been like a decade since I read that.
I'm
so.
A Greek mythology junkie.
Oh, dude. Fucking. Love it. Oh, anyway, yeah.
Right.
Well, he said in 1859, rail travel at high speed is not possible because passengers, unable to breathe, would die of asphyxia. I don't think you understand.
Well, I guess we won't talk about those maglev trains that go 700 miles an hour.
Yeah, nobody told about
if
that.
If only we had real trains in the United States, we could actually have better public transport. Eh,
we got cars, we don't need fucking trains.
Yeah, well,
when I could get on a train, go to work, and then drive it to the fucking Rite Aid, and then drive to the grocery store, then drive it home again, I'll get a fucking train.
Well, yeah. Japan's kind of like that. But.
Well, Japan needs trains, because if everyone had cars, there'd be no room for people.
Right.
This is from W.C. Huber, National Cancer Institute, 1954.
Oh, snap.
If excessive smoking actually plays a role in the production of lung cancer, it seems to be a minor one.
Yeah, not entirely true.
Yeah. These are some super cool versions of the future that never happen. From the book, The Age of Spiritual Machines by Ray Kurzweil, published in 1999, who made predictions in 10-year increments.
All right.
So these would have definitely come true by now. Number one, the majority of text is created using continuous speech recognition.
Yeah.
Not so much. Number two, most routine business transactions, purchases, travel, and reservations, take place between a human and a virtual personality.
Kind of true, orbits and all that.
The virtual presentation includes an animated visual presence that looks like a human face.
Oh, well, that's not true. No, you count William Shatner, but yeah.
Yeah, well... Hey, man, don't talk shit on the Shat, all right? Yes, I
don't
just
shit
said
on
that.
The Shat.
Don't shit on the Shat, all right? Number three, translating telephones, that's speech-to-speech language translation, are commonly used for many language pairs.
As awesome as that would be, that'll never happen.
No, no. They're working on it. They are working on it, but it's not like what he thinks.
No, we need more Babelfish for that.
Yes. Number four, human musicians routinely jam with cybernetic musicians. I think that's when the LSD started kicking in.
Yeah. Unless you're talking about dubstep.
Good point. This next one was from Alex Lewitt, a president of vacuum cleaner company, Lewitt Corporation, in the New York Times in 1955. Nuclear-powered vacuum cleaners will probably be a reality in 10 years.
So 1965, huh?
Yeah, they also said they'll be completely automated.
That would also be awesome.
Well, this guy, what, do you watch the fucking Jetsons and come up with this shit? Really
fucking Jetsons shit right there. That's great.
Hope taping is killing music. A 1980s campaign by the BPI claiming that people recording music off the radio onto cassette would entirely destroy the music industry.
Wow. They're funny. Those same people are saying the same shit about the internet.
Oh, that's something. I guess we know where to file that bullshit under. Yep.
Oh, and Sony has claimed that they will no longer be making cassette players as of 2013.
Well, I'm full up on cassette players, so yeah. I should be fine.
Also, they will no longer be producing PlayStation 2s. The last ones were rolled off the factory line. There will be no more
it's my favorite system.
Made ever.
Cool. Well, I still have two of them, so I should be all right.
I have one of the
I've
slim
actually,
ones.
It's hard to pay attention when I come in here because I'm just like queued
oh, yeah, it's
up
like
to the
right
Super
over
Nintendo
there.
With
Super
Mario
Nintendo.
In it.
It's got the PlayStation 2 and the original Xbox right next to it. Got to do something while I'm waiting for the shit to process, process the show. You try treating 2.5 hours of audio, which is big, giant audio files. You basically, you're like, I got to do something because this is going to take 20 fucking minutes.
Yep.
In the 1995 Newsweek column, Stahl said that, quote, no online database will replace your daily newspaper. No CD-ROM can take the place of a competent teacher, and no computer network will change the way the government works.
Wow. Way wrong, that guy.
Way off base. This next one is Time Magazine. Your mail will be delivered within hours. No, wait. I'm sorry. I totally fucked that up. I just fucked up my own prediction.
Oh, son of a bitch.
Okay, this is Arthur Summerfield, the U.S. Postmaster General. Your mail will be delivered within hours from NYC to Australia by guided missiles, 1955.
That would be awesome, actually.
Incoming letter! Get to the shelters! Holy
oh, it's
mackerel.
Just a bill.
That's a whole new way of being e-bombed.
This next one is from Time Magazine.
Fuck you, that was funny.
Aww, she gave you a sympathy laugh.
That's only because she loves me, but she knows it was terrible.
No, but that made
look
it funny.
At him, he tried to make a joke.
Oh, that's cute. How's that radio show going for you?
Yeah. Pete, we're not on the radio.
Sure. Well, radio's dead, too. I hope there's a radio prediction in there.
You know, there might be. This next one's Time Magazine. Remote shopping will flop. So that's basically ordering shit off the internet.
Right, about to say. Yeah, that's yes. The only way most people do it. You can even get groceries from the internet.
Also, the same Time Magazine article said there will be robot pets. That's true. The end of the 20th century, pets don't know. No, that's what I said at first. I'm like, Furby.
So far, the statement was true.
Oh, yes, yes. That's what I thought. And then I read on. Pets will be wired with brain electrodes, allowing them to close windows or adjust beds on command. So they're talking about like cybernetically controlled slave dogs and shit.
No.
Well, they do put GPSs in dogs now, but they're not exactly GPSs. They're, hey, if you find my dog, they put a little chip inside them and it has the address of where they belong.
Yeah, which is actually kind
of
cool.
But that same dog, you can find him, but you can't have him change the height of your bed.
Yeah that's not
or set your coffee up.
Happening.
Yeah, one thing at
a cat. You know, the fucked up thing is a cat could do that.
They just choose not
to. Would.
Yeah, no. They don't like you that much.
In the world.
You could tell them, you know what, I hate coffee. You'd hear that coffee maker click on. Dumbass cat. It turned out she just pissed it instead of putting water in it. Oh, ammonia-flavored Maxwell House.
Boy.
Roger Smith, a GM chairman, said, "By the turn of the century, we will live in a completely paperless society."
As I read this off of paper.
Which came off of my computer that my dog printed for me.
Of which there are only five.
Yes. Only five in the world. We pass them around. We live in them because of the size of houses with big vacuum tubes. Automotive Lovely. Designer Eddie Rickenbacker predicted that flying cars would be the vehicle of the future. Still hasn't fucking happened.
Yeah, waiting on that. That'd be great, though.
Yeah. Popular Mechanics in 1949 said, "Where a calculator on the iNAC is equipped with 18,000 vacuum tubes and weighs 30 tons, computers in the future may have only 1,000 vacuum tubes and weigh only 1.5 tons.
Well,
wow.
They might, but...
My cell phone has a few vacuum tubes in it, still, I think.
What's funny is when when you're looking at music equipment, you want vacuum tubes. It sounds so good. But there's still only like four.
Yeah, not 1,000.
And it weighs like a pound.
This was attributable to Bill Gates in 1981. And Pete, I saw this and I thought, oh, Pete's going to love this.
Okay.
640K ought to be enough for anybody.
640K of what? Does it say?
It doesn't say.
Wow. Well, it reminds me of when, because every time I think about it, when I first got into computers, 32 megs of RAM was standard, and 64 was overkill.
Yeah.
You got 64 megabytes of RAM on your computer? Holy shit, let's play Diablo 1.
Yeah. Think it can handle it?
Oh, sign on to AOL.
Mine still has vacuum tubes in it.
But it would,
that... Yep. Then you finally get connected and someone picks up the phone. You're like, son of a bitch.
Oh, God damn it.
This is H.M. Warner from Warner Brothers in 1927. It made me laugh because it still kind of holds true today.
Okay.
Who the hell wants to hear actors talk? And in the movie's fine, but outside of the movie, usually, no. We still, Mr. Warner, we still really don't want to hear it. He obviously had to speak to a lot of actors. It's who wants to fucking hear him talk? God! Dude, you're getting off light. You only have to look at them. This one's a little bigger, but it's cute. This is Apple computer founder Steve Jobs on attempts to get Atari and HP interested in his and Steve Wozniak's personal computer.
Oh, yeah.
So we went to Atari and said, "Hey, we've got this amazing thing, even built with some of your parts. What do you think about funding us? Or we'll give it to you. We just want to do it. Pay our salary, we'll come work for you." And they said, no. So then we went to Hewlett-Packard, and they said, "Hey, we don't need you. You haven't been through college yet." So it's just kind of funny.
How fucking Jobs, even dead, has more money than fucking everybody but Bill Gates in that industry.
Yep. And our last one from the World Economic Forum, 2004. This is Bill Gates. 2 years from now, spam will be solved. The spam crisis continues. Like the coming
both
cold.
In the can and in your email.
Yes.
That is pretty spam. Awesome.
So those were our failed predictions.
Okay. That's... Oh, yeah, because only some of us can sling it outside.
Oh, my God. Oh yes, you go pee-pees on the inside.
You know where it is?
Oh, probably. Yes. Yeah, life's usually pretty friendly with
there's
that.
There's girls in there.
Okay. That brings us to weird news.
Oh, snap, weird news.
Oh,
I
yes.
The news
some of which weird. Is brought to you by way of Chuck Shepard's newsoftheweird.com, some from The Smoking Gun, and some from random sorted APR news sources scattered throughout the interwebs.
Oh, yeah.
The first story is titled The Art of BSing, which I got
of
my
which
degree.
We are really good.
Oh, yeah. We got our master's in this shit.
Hell to the yeah.
In fact, you're about to hear us use our skills now.
Yep.
The head of the Per Se School in Cambridge, England, recently instituted a 10-second rule for minor disciplinary infractions.
Is that if your write-up hits the floor, it's only good if it's picked up before 10 seconds?
No, this is actually pretty cool. Students could avoid punishment if they quickly produced a clever explanation for their misbehavior.
Awesome.
Getting children to talk their way out of a tight corner in a very short period of time, said Ed Elliott, encourages creativity and could produce a generation of British entrepreneurs.
That's great.
Sounds like the teachers were just bored and just were like, let's
I got a great idea.
Yeah.
In 10 seconds, to tell us why they fucked up or whatever.
Sell us on it. Set a supporter. Often the ones who get further are the Artful Dodgers, which, by the way, should be our band name. Who bent the truth?
I'm pretty sure that's already a thing.
Oh, really? Some of a bitch. Elliot warned that, though, that out-and-out falseness would not be tolerated. So they could, like, make up a ridiculous lie. They had to really sell that shit. It's BBC News. 19th of November. Next one is our strange but true category.
Okay.
This first one's called Boing.
so many things come to mind.
Police in Geraldton, Australia, reported in November that they had captured a thief they were chasing in the dark through a neighbor's backyard. As the thief came to a fence and leapt over it, he happened to land on a family's trampoline and was then propelled backward, practically into the police officer's laps.
That's great.
Australian Broadcasting Corporation News.
Wow, how pissed do you think he was?
Yeah, I'm getting away. I'm going over the fence. Lazy ass cops won't chase me over there. Boing. Oh, back. You got to give up fucking crime because your luck is like a negative 20.
That's like some shit from a fucking comedy that you couldn't possibly hope to write.
Fucking ridiculous. This next one's called Leatherface versus Mary Poppins.
Begin.
Guy Black, age 76, was charged in Turboville, Pennsylvania, in October with threatening housemate Ronald Tanner with a chainsaw. Tanner, defending himself with the only weapon within reach, an umbrella, managed to pin Black with it as the chainsaw jammed. Most people who bring an umbrella to a chainsaw fight would be less successful. This is from the Associated Press via WPVI Television in Philadelphia.
That's awesome.
So Mary Poppins wins. Flawless victory.
that's great.
It's ridiculous.
I stole your chocolate.
Oh, that's quite all right. We have plenty of it. This next one's called Pass the Gas. A federal employee who is a claims authorizer at the SSA Center that handles disability cases for the entire country was formally reprimanded this month for excessive workplace flatulence. A sanction that was delivered to him in a 5-page letter that actually included a log of representative dates and times when he was recorded, quote, releasing the awful and unpleasant odor, end quote, in his...
A strongly worded letter.
Throughout his Baltimore office. That's exactly the voice I had pictured for this, by the way. In a December 10th letter accusing him of, quote, conducting... conduct unbecoming a federal officer. The Social Security Administration employee was informed that his uncontrollable flatulence had created an intolerable and hostile environment for coworkers, several of whom have lodged complaints with his supervisors.
What are you writing down? Every time he goes to the bathroom.
The worker, a 38-year-old Maryland resident, reportedly provided evidence that he suffered from some medical conditions that at times caused him to be unable to work full days. But an SAA manager noted in the reprimand letter that, quote, nothing that you have submitted has indicated that you would have uncontrollable flatulence. It is my belief that you can control this condition, end quote. According to the letter of reprimand, which is the least severe administrative sanction that can be levied against a federal worker,
I guess
the man was the most severe is having to work with the guy who fucking shits himself all day. The man was first spoken to about his flatulence during a May 18th performance discussion with his supervisor.
Now, that reminds me of a certain other discussion a supervisor had to have.
I was just about to say that.
He was in.
Yeah.
He was informed that fellow employees had complained about his flatulence and that it was the reason none of them were willing to assist him with his work. I have a problem. You're damn right you have a fucking problem. The supervisor referred the employee to an SAA unit for, quote, assistance with what could have been a medical problem that was affecting everyone in his module. 2 months later, on July 17th, a second SSA manager spoke with the man in regards of your releasing of bodily gas in the module during work hours.
Wow.
The manager asked
I like all the just like the really formal writing
formal
language
speak
behind
for
that.
Just being a farty marty. The manager asked the employee if he could make it to the restroom before releasing the awful and unpleasant odor. She also recounted what appeared to be a prior conversation during which the worker suggested that they could turn your fan on when it happens. The manager recalled advising him that, quote, turning on the fan would cause the smell to spread and worsen the air quality in the module. What, are they on the fucking Apollo 16 module or what?
Apparently there's no windows here.
On August 14th, a third administrator, the SSA Deputy Division Director.
Oh, wow. It's getting serious now.
Oh, shit got real. Spoke with the worker about his continuous releasing of your bodily gas and the terrible smell that comes with the gas. They almost get into like Victorian era speak with this shit. The manager noted that the worker had said he was lactose intolerant and planned to purchase GasX, an over-the-counter remedy. The manager informed the employee that he may wish to take the tablets rectally. No, that he... Have you tried a fucking... I almost said a Robitussin enema, but I meant to say Kalpectate enema. But what the fuck? Try Robitussin too. Just shove everything up there. A fifth of scotch. Who gives a fuck? Get your asshole drunk. It has to smell better. But he could not...
That's gross.
The manager did inform the employee that he could not pass gas indefinitely and continue to disrupt the workplace. Despite the repeated warnings...
This is a long fucking story.
Oh, it is. The man apparently continued to struggle with his flatulence through the late summer into the fall.
I imagine him battling with a smoke monster of ass gas.
No, not again. After stating...
It's like Lost, how they had that smoke monster.
Yeah, they wished he would get lost with his smoke monster.
Gross.
After stating that, quote, "It is my belief that you can control this condition," end quote, the author of the reprimand letter then noted, "The following dates show the time of your flatulence. What followed was a log listing 17 separate dates and 60 specific times on which the employee passed gas. For example, the man's September 19th output included 9 instances of flatulence, beginning at 9:45 a.m. and lasting until 4:30 p.m. That's some long... How do you squeeze so much gas into your body?
Like, but I mean, and even then, shouldn't that guy have something better to do than log every time this guy farts? Like, what the fuck? He's having so much lost productivity going, oh, I farted again. Let me log that down.
With these Byzantine structures of fucking, to describe he farted real bad. It was awful. It smelled like ketchup and onions and a dead hooker. The man
like
was
Fritos and ass.
Fritos and ass. The man was also accused of launching a trio of attacks on September 11th. It gets weirder. The reprimand letter does not reveal how the worker's flatulence was memorialized, nor whether that unfortunate task fell to labor or management. The letter's author wrote that the employee's conduct had been discourteous, disrespectful, and entirely inappropriate, and was worthy of formal sanction, which is placed in a worker's personnel files for up to 1 year. The reprimand, the manager noted, is the least severe penalty available to impress upon you the seriousness of your actions and is necessary to deter further misconduct of your ass.
Oh, wow.
Pump up the volume, and robberies is our next story.
Oh, yes.
A knife-wielding thief made off with $250 in cash and a $150 penis pump during a robbery early Sunday morning at an adult novelty shop in Dallas, police report. The aggravated robbery of Zone D... I thought this was a name, and I almost said Zone A de Erotica. No, that's not a person's name. Zone of the Erotic, Zone de Erotica. Occurred at 4:45 a.m. when the suspect displayed a knife and then demanded money, according to a Dallas Police Department report.
Behold, my knife. Now give me your money and a penis pump.
In addition to fleeing with $250, the thief also walked out of the Forest Lane business with a penis pump valued at $150. The report does not provide a description of the armed robber other than that of his gender, which is, of course, male.
And he needs a larger dick.
Yes. Or maybe he just wants to get a, a fatter dick. I don't know.
That's true.
Something to keep warm at night.
Do a little.
Or you can work out with it. Do power squats.
Yeah, my cock is huge.
So big, I'm working out just taking a leak.
I got him that blue rubber band thingy that you were talking about.
Say...
Stretchy.
What's that into the microphone?
Yeah. I said I got him the blue stretchy rubber band thing you were talking about on one of your podcasts.
What? For exercising purposes, not penis.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
purposes.
Yeah. I was thinking sex toy. I'm like, fuck, I say a lot
that's
of really
weird shit.
That's
what he thought when he first saw it, too. And I took it out in front of his mom. He was like, what's that?
Well, that stuff's great because you could, like, have your foot down on one end and, like, do curls in your other hand while you're doing mouse stuff with the computer. And it's fucking cool. Oh, I love that shit. This next one's called A Crime of Desperation. clearly a crime of desperation.
Yeah, if you're stealing a penis pump. Oh, wait, no. No, next one. Right.
Oh, this is worse. In a bid to capture the armed robber who last month stole a $250 sex doll from an Iowa City adult store, police today released a surveillance photo showing the suspect making off with the item.
Making out?
I have to describe it to you because it's essentially just a woman's rear end. Like the legs, there's like maybe 3 inches of legs and 3 inches of back, and it's just all like she's booty, bent over, and it's all booty. I guess you would set it on a tabletop. The look of horror coming from your girlfriend is priceless.
Yeah, that's
you just made my
why
podcast.
She's great for this. Too bad it's an audio thing.
It was a ski mask clad man carrying the sex doll inside the Romantics Pleasure Palace shop at around 3 a.m. on January 12th. Before releasing the store surveillance photo, however, police had to pixelate it to obscure explicit images. On the box of the, quote, fuck me silly number one model mega masturbator. As previously reported, the stolen 20-pound sex doll is described by its manufacturer as, looks like it came off a butcher shop floor.
Wow.
It's described by its manufacturer as the most realistic piece of ass you ever fucked. There's more. Slap that big round ass and listen to the whack. There's more. It sounds and feels just like a real ass.
So, wow. So that's like the ass counterpart of a fleshlight?
Yes, it's like a fleshlight with just the butt cheeks and a little of the...
Wow, that's crazy. I was contemplating getting one of those, and then I got, you know, a girlfriend. So.
Yeah, you got like the whole deal with the whole vagina support system.
Self-lubricating
attached.
And everything. Oh, that's the tits. Best. It's amazing.
According to police, the robber displayed a large hunting knife to a Romantics employee. What do you think? Oh, it's a nice knife.
Huh?
Okay.
I'm sorry, I got distracted.
Distracted thinking of breasts, it's completely understandable.
Yeah. I also am getting a call for time as well.
Oh, according to police, the robber displayed a large hunting knife to a Romantics employee before leaving with the sex doll. Police described the suspect as a white male, approximately 5'8 to 5'10, 165 pounds, not including the sex doll.
Right, that's another 20, and then the knife is probably another good 5.
In return for information leading to the man's arrest, Iowa City Area Crime Stoppers are offering an award of up to $1,000. And now for our final really gross story. I like to get in little, you know, in little motifs there.
Oh, yeah. I hope it's another sex toy related thing.
Oh, boy. Old McDonald had a sex toy.
Oh, Jesus.
A week has passed. Police have yet to make an arrest in the crash and grab theft of an $800 Pipe Dream Extreme Fuck Me Silly 3 Mega Masturbator from an Ohio sex shop.
Is that the what actual mouthful. Name of the toy?
It's the Pipe Dream Extreme Fuck Me Silly 3 Mega Masturbator.
Wow. That's crazy. It's the same sex shop. Sounds like it said Ohio, right?
It may just be. Man, this place gets... Just stop selling. You leave all the stoop. At least you won't have a broken window. The subject, deputies noted... I got ahead of myself.
Yeah, with a title like that in a sex toy, yeah.
Lorain County Sheriff's Office investigators are still hunting for the man who last Monday used a stolen tractor to open the rear doors to the adult mart in Brownhelm Township.
Wow. Stole a tractor to steal a sex toy.
Yeah. That guy had a plan.
Masturbator. That's insane.
He had a plan. It was weird as fuck.
Yeah, right?
As if stealing like a part of what looks like a cadaver to fuck in the ass. Let's see. Surveillance video revealed that after busting the doors apart around 2:25 a.m., a white male perpetrator and penetrator wearing a royal blue hoodie ran in and swiped the masturbator, according to an amusing sheriff's report. Bet they just came up like a bunch of fucking buffoons when they penned that little report.
So, White, I'm going to need you to describe it again.
Probably, could you have an extra one? We need it for evidence so we can study it to understand how he thinks. We're all married, please. It'll get you out of traffic tickets if you just load us one.
That's the masturbator guy. No, you're good.
They just keep it in a holding cell. I'm not going in that holding cell. Jamie to the floor. The subject, deputies noted, then left it in an unknown direction of travel, both metaphysically and literally,
yeah.
with the masturbator.
Known direction of travel.
Which its manufacturer, Pipe Dream Products, describes as, quote, over 20 pounds of legs, ass, and pussy.
Wow. Had a girl like that once.
Oh, damn you. Damn it. Damn it. Son of a bitch.
Yep. Jumped on that one real quick.
Yeah. Yeah, you tore into that fucking punchline like, I don't know, a stolen tractor. The item, made of quote, Fanta flesh, lifelike skin. I didn't realize, is this Fanta a drink? A soda?
Fanta. Like soda.
Yeah. It kind of
looks
smells
like
oranges. Ooh, it's fizzy inside.
It kind of smells like herpes.
How does taste feel? And
it smells of Valtrex and corn chips. I don't like this. Oh, I know I should have gotten a used one. Fanta flesh, lifelike skin. Replicates
stuff you don't want to get off the eBay.
Yes. Replicates a woman's body from the waist down. The Mega Masturbator, Pipe Tree reports, is the most realistic and lifelike lower half of a woman ever developed. Aside from the actual lower half of a woman.
It's just illegal to only take the lower half.
Yeah. Oh my god, this is fucking crazy.
That's so awesome.
An hour after the August 22 break-in, August 22nd break-in, Carl, it's 22nd.
I was all right with it either way.
A sheriff's deputy spotted the Volvo tractor, not Volva, Volvo, tractor, used to slam into Adult Mart in the nearby city of Elyra.
This is just full of innuendos, this is an article.
The suspect bolted from the tractor and was able to escape apprehension by Deputy Wiegman, probably because he was laughing so hard. The report does not indicate whether the masturbator thief was in possession of the extreme Fuck Me Silly 3 at the time, though the item has not been subsequently recovered. When collared, the suspect will face a variety of felony charges.
Most of them hilarious.
Including theft and breaking and entering.
Oh, that's pretty
Our
great.
Last little tale is the lap dancer from hell. This one, you all remember back in the day, there was that dancer who falsely accused the group of Duke lacrosse players of sexual assault, and it turned out to be completely bogus, but everybody jumped on it.
Very much like
except for the Duke lacrosse players, apparently. The woman who falsely accused a group of Duke lacrosse players of sexual assault was arrested yesterday for allegedly stabbing her boyfriend in the chest during an argument in the victim's North Carolina home. Crystal Magnum, age 32, I guess she still kept her dancing name.
Yeah.
Was booked into Durham County Jail, where she is being held without bond on an assault with a deadly weapon charge. The victim suffered serious injuries in the attack and is hospitalized at the Duke University Hospital.
Uh-oh.
Puff, puff.
Hopefully he doesn't have, I don't know. There's going to be a lacrosse player joke in there, but I fucked it all up, so I apologize.
Put it back on the burner when it's ready, roll it out. According to Durham Police Deputy reports, Magnum stabbed Reginald Day, 46, with a kitchen knife with the intent to kill and inflict serious injury.
In that order?
Yes,
that seems
in that
silly.
Injury. Yes. I want to kill him and then inflict serious injury. The 3:15 a.m. assault occurred in Day's apartment on Century Oaks Drive in Durham, so I guess right when she was done work, she just started stabbing.
Meth's a hell of a drug.
Well, maybe she got home and he had like one of those ultra mega phantom
Fuck
sex
me
part 3.
9,000 yes. Or something.
Robot ass 6,000.
The pipe dream. Fuck me silly 5,000.
The Bootytron 3. Last February.
I got this off the back of a trailer, a tractor, baby.
He just mounted it to the front of the trailer and then he mounted it on the front of the trailer. I know I went there. Last February, Magnum was arrested for allegedly assaulting Milton Walker, her then boyfriend, and threatening to stab him. She was also accused of setting fire to the man's clothes. She was convicted in December of several misdemeanors, including child abuse, since her torching of Walker's garments nearly burned down a home occupied by several minors.
Yeah, this is
she's a
kind
winner.
Of woman we want to believe
in. In 2006, Magnum, who worked as an exotic dancer, claimed that she was sexually assaulted while performing at a party attended by members of the Duke lacrosse team. Rape charges against three athletes were eventually dismissed when the North Carolina Attorney General realized she was a crazy hoe, determined that there was insufficient evidence to back Magnum's claims.
And she was a crazy hoe.
And she was a crazy motherfucking hoe.
Holy shit.
So, boy, if they didn't feel vindicated already, they got to be like,
that's got to help.
See? See?
We told you.
Told you she was a crazy hoe.
Well, you know, well, being that she's a stripper like that, it means she probably ended up dating one of the guys who's somebody else's ex-boyfriend, and then he ended up with a dog and a kid. Or
she married him, picked up an extra child and a tractor and part of a sex doll, just the leg. So she got to have a leg fetish, or else it's lost on you. Or eventually you'll just build a complete woman out of sexual toy parts with dildos
like
for fingers.
Of the Lambs 5.
Yes. Would you fuck me? I'd fuck
Damn
me.
Damn it!
I mean, of course you'd fuck me. You're an animate fucking sex doll, but he comes home and like one of his friends is fucking it. No, you dirty whore! You franken whore! You fuck you!
He puts the KY on the sex doll and gets the hose.
What's
the girl I don't like?
What? Sex doll?
Franken whore.
Franken whore?
Yes.
Franken whore.
Like next is going to be Franken whore.
Franken whore, Franken slut is another good one because it has that strong slut at the end. Very good. Franken whore is almost friendly.
You could almost tell your mom.
Yeah, like, you know, you could dress up as Franken whore for Halloween and it would still be okay. Franken slut, however, insidious.
She a skanky bitch.
Oh, yeah. Yes. So what do we learn today? At our last podcast of the year 2012.
Oh, yeah.
Year 12,002.
The last podcast of 12,002.
Yes, it is. The end of 2012 comes to a close. We learned that people are in desperate times, but not quite so desperate that they will break in to get sex toys.
Yeah, with tractors, even.
With stolen Volvo tractors. all over the place.
That's crazy.
We learned that strippers can be crazy.
Yes, and
don't believe them necessarily because they may lie to you.
It's like this is some fucking revelation.
Yeah, well, you know, people might not know about Franken sluts out there. Now they know. You gotta watch out for them.
Battle.
You gotta watch out for them.
There's half the battle, which is better than half the sex toy.
Exactly,
just half a woman.
Well, apparently you only need that much. I mean, does he like put pillows around the front part and like just put a blanket over it and just pretend?
Not like he can jizz on its tits because it's only ass and legs.
Well, I guess if you had it on the table and you were like watching a television program over here, you could grip the butt cheeks, I guess, and just have at it.
I suppose. Maybe we should attempt to reenact this and see.
I do like that position.
Well, where are you going to get a tractor this time of night?
Well, I'll have to steal one, clearly.
Oh, well, yes. I'll complete the whole thing, I guess.
I know, dude.
I know a farmer. I borrowed tractors off the middle of the night before. We need a tractor. Just fine. Take the keys. Just top off the gas tank, would you?
And do clean up any mess.
Clean up the seats. And don't leave any sex toys attached to it because it's weird to plow my field with dildos on the front of a tractor.
I don't want
to
plow my field after you've plowed a field.
Plowed a field.
I mean.
Waka, waka, waka. So 2012 draws to a close. We'd like to thank all of you listeners who've been listening and telling friends. So for our goal for 2013,
is to at least get 3 more of you.
Yes, and to get on iTunes, which we're just going to keep banging your heads against that wall till eventually some part of us gets through.
And for all our new European listeners.
Yes, who may be listening. Buongiorno.
Hello. And
hola. And guten tag. And whatever the fuck they say in Romania. Shit like that. So thank you all for listening, and we hope we've made you happy.
Yes. So, from all of us here at That's Life Podcast, this has been Pete.
And yeah, Carl. Bidding you an adieu, an adieu. And don't forget the sex toy, adieu.
Behold, my knife. Now give me your money and a penis pump.